Okay, so I'm really happy to be back. I was really lucky to present 2 years ago for the first R2Con. And today I want to show you a project I started almost 3 years ago about a Japanese SD card, which is called the Toshiba Flash Air. So, quickly. Radar and me, I don't use Radar that much. I just started using the project 2 years ago, mainly for this project. On the way, I developed many plugins, like R2Scapy to be able to decode memory in, packets in memory with Scapy. I developed another plugin called R2M2 that I will present today. That's the tool I presented 2 years ago in R2Con. From time to time, I'm trying to report issues and fix them, and I have this kind of silly topic this day. I've been playing with AFL in order to fuzz R2 commands. So here on the right, that's a bunch of commands I use to segfault R2. Thanks to the R2 developers, are all fixed, but that's the kind of stuff I do with R2, trying to play with it. This talk was first presented 1 month ago in Black Hat US, and today I will do a short version. Hopefully I will keep my time, and this short version will focus on R2, so I will try to provide as much R2 command as possible. So my goal today is to share my personal story of reversing this Flash Air card. During this talk, I will explain how you can execute code on the card yourself, and hopefully I would like to give you enough elements that will help you to buy the card and reproduce everything yourself. During this talk, I will use only open source tools. One of them is R2, and I will also show you the tools that I developed specifically for this project. So the goal today is to print a calc, that's why there is this picture on the right. I said before, I'm not a hardcore R2 user, so let me know if some comments in the slide are incorrect, and I will try to improve myself. If you need to follow the slide along, you can take a picture, it's quite big, or you can try to use a QR code in order to retrieve the slide. So let's briefly discuss the Flash Air features. Toshiba Flash Air card, that's SD card from Toshiba. There are many uses to enhance your digital camera in order to retrieve your pictures over Wi-Fi. These cards, they provide a Wi-Fi access point that you can connect to with your laptop or smartphone. And they also expose a file named config that you can edit and change some parameters. Like, for example, you can change the Wi-Fi password to something more robust than the default 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This talk will focus only on this card, which is Flash Air W03. It was the only one available when I started this project in 2015, and today you can buy it for €25. Before executing code on the card, we need to retrieve some information. So here's the game plan today. First, we need to retrieve some memory dump. Then we'll need to discover the architecture. It's not ARM. It's not something more exotic. Then on the way to code execution, we need to discover the operating system. And finally, find a way to execute code. So let's try to do that. So the first thing we can explore are the updates. You can download them online on the Toshiba website. And back in 2015, the only firmware available was version v3.0.0. And the talk today will focus only on this firmware version. So the address that you will see, they are only related to this version. However, the final demo will be based on .01 to show you that if you buy a card today, you can execute code on the card yourself. So let's have a quick look at these installers. You can find two, one for Windows, one for Mac. And the best way to extract any useful information is just to go for the macOS zip file, unzip it, and then explore the content. Here I try to show what you can do with R2 zip, and then you can just give the zip file in order to explore the content. In this zip file, you will find a config file, so that the file used to configure the card, as well as a 1 megabyte large binary update, which is named fwupdate.fbn. If you want to read this file directly from R2, that's the line you need to use, command line you need to use. The config files, this one, they contained a lot of useful details about the update function, and without reversing anything, you can understand easily that the update tool will first copy the binary to the card, then edit the config file and add the following command, which is command equal update, dash f, the name of the binary, dash rm, dash reboot. And then what you need to do is eject and insert the card again. If you try to use tools such as Beanwalk, you won't find anything useful. You just be able to discover that there's a HTML file and XML file in the binary. So we need to do something more in order to explore the, this binary. For example, we can use radar in order to explore the strings inside. So to do so, I will use these commands. First, I will change the block size with B. I will use a block size of 32K. If you have a bigger screen than mine, I have a small Chromebook, you can use a bigger value, of course, a smaller value, sorry, of course. P equals Z will give you this output, and mainly it's displaying the number of strings per block. So what we can see here, at first, we don't have much strings, and we have a bunch of strings at the end. So it's likely that this part of your data, the end, is not encrypted and not compressed. Then we can seek to this section, that this one here in red, with a big number of strings, and we can use PSB for print string in block in order to display string in the binary. And some are really interesting. For example, this one, setIP with format strings, they're really interesting because they are likely related to printf function, and they will allow us to explore the firmware deeper. In this binary, there is 15,000 strings, and today I will only describe two at first. The first one is eva.cgi. You can access this file over HTTP by connecting to the Wi-Fi access point on the card before. It's really interesting because it looks like the output buffer. And if you connect to the eva.cgi script, you can see this screen. So here in blue, we can see that at first, the card when it boots is looking for access point around, and then at some point, it's starting the DHCP server. This screen is really important because we'll be able to retrieve a lot of information by connected to it. Second string is telnet, and in the binary, in the update, it was really close to parameter names used in the config file. And if you add telnet equal one to config and reboot, and if you go back to eva.cgi, a new string will appear, it's telnet start. And of course, a telnet daemon will be started on port 23 TCP. There's a trick here, if you use telnet, it won't work. You need to enable the character mode, and that way your client will send one character, the server will acknowledge it, and so on. So you need to activate this character mode to be able to interact with the card. So next, we can ask for help. We have two ways to do that. We can use the help keyword in commands, or we can use the help command in telnet. We are lucky because both ways will give the same results, which are 32 commands. I'll only put the first one here. So this one mod is interesting. It says modify memory. So when I first saw it, I really believed it was a quick solution to get code executed on the card. So it's not. Why? Because mod is only modifying data, not code. So there's no way we can change something here. And this CPU is off, on top of that is likely doing executing place. So there is no way we can use that to execute something useful. The dump and fdump commands are really cool, and we will use them later in order to get a bigger memory dump from the card. So we have a good understanding of the card. We can connect to the card using telnet. We can execute commands. However, we don't have enough information to execute anything. So what we can do next is try to have a look at the card internals. So that's a big picture of the card. So here in blue, we have components dedicated to the flash memory. And the big die here, that's your data. In yellow, that's the SPI flash storing the code. It's 2 megabytes large. And the update being 1 megabyte, we are likely missing some important data. In green, that's the 802.rf transceiver. That's the physical layer, 802.11 physical layer. It's named AL2238. It's important because later on, we'll refer to this string to understand what is going on with the SPI flash. In red, that's a SOC from Toshiba, TC19535XBG. If you look online, you won't find anything interesting besides that it's 32-bit RISC and that it was released in 2013. So we don't know the architecture yet. So if we want to investigate further, we need to get a bigger memory dump. To do so, we can use a dump and fdump command from the flash air. So you can do that in config or in telnet. Both will give you a dump in a text format. Indeed, these commands are not really useful if you want to dump manually, because they can only give you back 384 bytes per call, so it's not that much. So if you do that manually, yeah, you need some coffee, it will be slow. So for this project, I developed FlashRay, which is available on GitHub. And the goal is to simplify interacting with the card, reversing the cards. That's a collection of tools that, for example, give you a telnet command to talk with the card, a dump command to dump the binary. Most of the things were done with R2Pipe in order to talk in between FlashRay and Radar. There is a Docker image that you can pull, and on the Docker image, you have FlashRay, Radar, and all of the tools that I will discuss today. So if you want to reproduce everything, you can use the Docker image. So let's try to get a bigger binary. That's quite simple. Just need to use the dump command FlashRay. You'll get a text file. Dumping the first 2 megabytes is slow. It will take 20 minutes. Anyway, it's automatic, so it's quite good. And then if you want to convert the text file to binary, you can use the convert parameter from dump, and then send the output to the binary. And in the end, you will get this dump wr3.bin binary, which is 2 megabytes large, which is the SPI flash. So we can go to game plan and check the first item, which is a memory dump. So we are slightly going somewhere. Next, we have a bigger binary, so we can try to identify the CPU. Again, Again, we'll try to do that by using strings. So in December 2015, a friend of mine discovered these two strings. They are really interesting because that's something you could use in order to print registers content. So here we can see that some registers start with R, R00, R01, and so on. And some are really specific to this architecture, like PSW, LP, and so on. So if you take these specific registers and put that in a search engine, like DuckDuckGo, you'll find that. That's a web page that is part of the CGEN documentation. It says that this architecture is named MEP. The cool part here is that CGEN, if you don't know, that's a tool used to convert CPU architectures written in Guile, a programming language, to C. And the really good news is that CGEN is used in binutils. So we can go online, download binutils, compile it with target equal map, with map support, and call objdump minus d on our binary. And we are really lucky because at first we have some jumps, so we are likely looking at good code. If you go at this address, 0x100, it's not garbage, it's a valid code. At that point of the project, I was really surprised to discover that the card is using MEP because this CPU seems to be unknown from the security community. So I decided to look for devices that also used MEP. At first, I discovered that it's used by some Toshiba products. So on the left, you have an MP3 player. In the middle, you have some image recognition system for Toshiba. And my biggest surprise is that it's also used in the PS Vita, and according to my understanding, is used as a secure element to store keys in the system. So the next missing element was the manual. You can get it online. You will learn that MEP means Media Embedded Processor. You can also learn that there are five different maps, from map C1 to map C5. The flasher is using map C4. It is a typical MIPS with 200 instructions. And for us, really important information that there is no privileged mode, and it's likely why we're able to dump memory from any process. So it's a typical MIPS, so I won't like talk about this slide longer. However, it has two really interesting instructions that could be interesting from Radar developer, I guess. They are repeat and irrepeat. These ones are really funky and specific, and their goal is to loop over a block of instructions. And to explain them, I will use the short strln implementation here on the right. So irrepeat will set to register RPB, repeat begin. In that case, that's a load byte instruction. It will also set repeat RPE, repeat end. Here, that's the add instruction. How it works, when PC will reach the instruction after RPE, so that's a branch here, it will be it will set back PC to RPB. So we have with irrepeat an infinite loop, an endless loop. I never saw this kind of instruction in other architectures, so I was really, really surprised. Repeat is the same, but it uses the second parameters to set another register called RPC, repeat count. In that case, we don't have an infinite loop. We loop over a specific number of time over the block. And I have to say, did not try to emulate this instruction with Radar, so I don't know yet if it's possible to express them with ASL, but that's something I would like to try. Okay, next we can get more information from the documentation. So here we can read that at address 0, we have something called external non-cache area of 2 megabytes. It contains a boot program as well as a reset and any my handlers. Indeed, at address zero, we have the full SPI flash. So if you dump at address zero, we'll also obtain the full SPI flash content. So the assembling at address zero is obj dump, as we saw before, works fine. However, we have an issue at higher addresses, and the calls, they seem broken. And it's likely the SPI flash is mapped at address zero and somewhere else. So I will show you that. And the main issue is that the BSR instruction is using signed offset relative to PC. So it means that the calls can go to lower and higher addresses. So if we disassemble with the base address of zero, for example, here we have a broken BSR call. And this FFA8A6 address is going really high, like really close to 4 gig. And I don't have 4 gig of memory on the flash here, of RAM. So to guess the best address, we'll use a tool named BaseFind. And BaseFind is really cool. It will test different base addresses and return the ones that are the most likely correct. 1 month ago, I opened a feature request on Radar because I think that's something that will be really cool in Radar 2. So that's 10.725. Okay, anyway, in that case, the solution that's address C00000. So it's BaseFind telling us that we should map the binary at this address. So let's try that with obj dump and the edges VMA arguments. And here that we can see that, wrong button. If we use the edges VMA parameter, the BSR call is fixed and is going somewhere. That means something, that it's going in our binary at address CFF8A6. If we try to disassemble here, we'll have a lot of map instruction. It's also a function. So we got this base address correctly. So let's go to the checklist. We have now two items. We can disassemble the binary with objdump, of course. But I don't know if you tried, but reversing with objdump is not that fun. It's flat. So there's no way to get the call graph. And indeed, you can't do anything useful. So let's try to discuss map tools that we need. Again, in 2015, I was really new to reversing. I had some wish lists in mind. I was looking for a tool that will be able to disassemble instruction with semantics to know, for example, where the jumps, the calls, and the branches are going in order to split blocks and have a call graph. Then I was looking for a tool to emulate instructions, and to me it's really helpful. So I'm new to reversing, I'm not that good, and emulation helped me to validate my understanding. For example, if I understand the function is strlen, I like to emulate it to check that indeed it's returning the correct string value. And finally, I need something that will display call graph and is navigating between them. And here I choose to use R2. Okay, so what I did next, I decided to implement a map disassembler myself. It was not a good idea, way too complicated for me. And I quickly decided to use something called MySM. It's a Python-based reverse engineering framework that can assemble, disassemble, and emulate instruction. And to me, the most important feature is that it's really easy to define a new architecture, like map. You need to define how to decode and encode instruction, and MySM will take care of the rest. Also, it's quite simple to express the instruction semantics yourself. So today, the MEP support in MySM is complete. It's online on MySM GitHub. All instructions can be assembled, disassembled, and emulated. It's really nice because we can benefit from tools like Sybil. Sybil is really nice because it helps you discover functions based on jitters. One of them is MySM. Sybil is doing its magic by emulating functions and checking for their side effects. For example, to detect strlen, again, I really like this function, really simple. It will pass one string at the first parameter and then check that the return value is equal to the length of the string. So Sybil is really easy to use. So here, that's a command line you could use to find function in the binary, gave it the list of the top 100 function in binary. It managed to discover 9 functions. Most of them are related to strings. I think it's really cool, 9 functions, because by doing nothing more than calling Sybil on an unknown binary, we're able to successfully find function and start exploring the binary. And again, these strings relating functions are really cool because they will help us to find more things, like, for example, function related to the network API. So finally, I need a tool to navigate the call graph. So that's Radar, but MySM is in Python and Radar in C. So I decided to write the R2M2 plugins. There is two, indeed. And these plugins are calling Python from C. It is designed to use MySM features from Radar. It's written with a Python CFFI module Why? Because R2Long is not able to allow you to write pure emulation and analysis analysis and emulation plugin AE plugins R2 plugins. So thanks to R2M2, we can assemble MEP and radar, and also emulate it because R2M2 is converting MySM expression into radar ASIL. So R2M2 is providing two plugins, AD for assembly and disassembly, and AE for analysis and emulation. And today I would like to describe the most important one, which is AE. And if you don't know, A stands for analysis. This part of the plugin is responsible to displaying these arrows. So they tell the radar where the jumps are going. So here the jumps are going to IO addresses. And because radar knows where the jumps, the calls, and the branches are going, it can also do a call graph. So that's the call graph, exactly the same output as objdump, but it's much more nicer, and we can navigate into that. E stands for emulation, and what I want to do here, I want to show you how we can emulate the first instruction in our binary. So first, you need to activate a nicer display, asm.emutrue, that will give you this comments on the right. Then you need to initialize ASL, the emulation, AEI, analysis, ASL, initialize. So if we disassemble two instructions, we have the first jumps. Then AES will step over the jump. And here on the left, we can see that we move from address 0 to address 100. So radar took the jump. So it's actually working. And yes, if we want to disassemble, we move to another section. So this example is really simple, but it shows that radar can emulate thanks to MySM expression. We can do more, and indeed during this project, I use similar tricks to discover some functions. We have an instruction in MEP, which is GSR, with jump, which is calling a function based on the register value. So I can show you how we can retrieve this R11 value. First, you need to initialize again the emulation. Then I will show you this pattern, move H, H3, GSR. I will step twice to AES. We'll show you where we are. So PC moved to move H to GSR. And then we can display the register value, R11, and get the address of the function. And if you do that automatically on the whole binary by using, for example, radar macro, you are able to retrieve all of this GSR-based function call. That's really cool. So we have tools. We can start reversing. And because there are a lot of strings in the binary, we'll try to reverse with strings. So let me drink, sorry. So if you look at the binary long enough, you will see a typical pattern used to display error messages. It uses four instructions here on the screen. First, it will load a format string into R1. So format string is using a string and an integer. And the most important information, that's the keyword in between square brackets, tel, means it's a string related to telnet. You will also find WPS strings, WPS and FATS. Then it will load the function name into R2, line number, and call printf. And the good point is that this function, when this pattern is used, is called telinitialize. So what we can do next is try to automate with R2 pipe. First, we'll assemble a moveU R1 instruction by using a specific format string. Search for the corresponding bytes with R2. Disassemble to check if we have a correct pattern. And finally, return the closest function prolog. And if you apply this step to the whole binary, we'll manage to identify 150 functions, again, by doing nothing more than calling a tool. And the really good part is that we know how the functions are used. Telnet, WPS, WPA, and so on. So let's have a look at the telnet-related function. Here we'll use a naming command from FlashRay. That's really easy to call, naming the name of the binary and then the offset on the correct base address. The output of naming, that's a valid R2 command, AF, that defines function for R2. What you can do, for example, if copy and paste AF tell send login message and this address into R2, and that will give you the following call graph. And the really good part here is that the first function called by tell send login message is named clear send buffer, and it was also discovered by autonaming. That's really cool because if you start reversing around the telnet related function, you will quickly be able to discover function related to the socket API, printf, malloc, free, and so on. So you are slightly progressing into the binary. So we have a better understanding of the binary. And before, again, executing some codes, we like to set two reverse engineering targets. The first one, that's the update function, and I will describe how it works, and then the configuration parser. So first, the update function. So this function is way too long to be on screen. We have a bigger screen, nice one, but the call graph is really too big. So I will go to the point and show you how it works. First, the update header, it's 32 bytes long. It will start with flash air, that's how it works. And then it uses a keyword to define the type of the update. It could be main2, boot, RF, Mac, or user PRG. The binary we saw before, fwupdate.fbn, started with flash air, so that's the output here on the right. The update command for flashRay is able to display the update header from any update binary by using scp on the binary. Finally, the checksum is 1 byte. It's really silly that the sum of all data bytes after the header. So that's, we are able to compute that really easily. The update command can display the header and also build fake updates. So we're on the way to execute something. These 5 types of updates are really important because they are used in an array, in this binary located at CEFF28, that is used to describe the SPI memory map. Indeed, these 5 types of updates, of sections, sorry, can be updated independently by the update function. Boot and main2, they contain MEP codes. And this is a really important result that shows that indeed the code MEP code is located at 2 different addresses, address 0 and somewhere else. I don't know the exact content of the other section, but MAC contains the MAC address. RF contains some binary data as well as a 2230 string. If you remind what I said before, 2238, it was the code name of the 802.11 RF transceiver. So it's likely that this RF binary is some kind of configuration parameters for the transceiver. And then user PRG is full of ones. And concerning main2 here, we have a really important result because during the update, the main2 section is erased with ones before being written to. So it means that the binary that we got, fwupdate.fbn binary, contains most of the code needed to reverse the card. No dumps are needed. There's no need to dump anything. We have everything we need. R2 can map structure to memory. So if we say that the structure is defined in section.h, we can launch it with TO. We can, with T, for example, display the internal radar documentation related to this section. Then we can define a macro, print section, that will print the section and then skip to the next element in the array. And then we call it twice to dump the first two sections in the array. And we can see that we have one section called main2, start around the address at 65k, it's 1.8 megabyte large. And that another section with boot start at address 0, and it's 65 kilobyte large. That's another really cool usage of R2. So next, what we can do, we can reverse the configuration parser. It's really an important piece of the of this research because it's used to configure values like the PSK. It will also start daemon like telnet or DHCP, and also it's used to execute commands. So in the parsconfig function, you can see this typical pattern that is used to check the parameters you are actually using in a config. First, it will load a string address into R1. It will load your parameter into R2 and called strcmp. And the cool part, again, here it's possible to define R2 macro, print string, that will extract the address from the first instruction and display its name. And if you do that automatically on R2, what you can do, you can list all parameters in the binary. So the trick here is just to search for the move you move BSR pattern, so that will the pattern that we'll use. The dot means that we don't want to actually give some values to these bytes. In order to reduce the search, we'll use search from with $fb, which is the beginning of the function, parsconfig function, same stuff to the end, fe, and from every match we have, we'll call the print string macro. That will give us the following results. We'll be able to extract 70 commands. That's really cool. That's 40 more commands, like the one in the documentation. So in yellow, you have some example, and for example, here we have commands and telnet. That's really cool. Next, we can have a look at the way telnet is started. And when the parsconvict function is processing the telnet parameter, it will call the telstart function, a string, really small. First thing it will do, it will print the telnet start string, the one we saw in ev.cgi. That's OK. We're actually reversing the good part. And then it's calling a function at address 81.22.58 with two parameters, 34 and 0. Okay, we don't know this function yet, and let's say I'm too lazy to reverse it, so we'll move on to the next part, which is common execution, and we'll try to go back to this 81.22.58 function later. So there is a chain of functions used to execute commands, but in the end, executing a function is done with a function I name execute command. It will call two functions, isValid and isAuthorize. These two are really interesting because they are using an array at address C9FF18. And looking closely at the memory at this array will reveal that it contains 47 elements. So I decided to name them commandT. So that's a structure definition of this commandT structure. And it's really important because you have the name of the function, of the command, as well as the pointer of the function. So we have actual code that we can reverse. So 47 elements, that's indeed 15 more commands than the 32 returned by the help commands. Again, we can use radar in order to automatically extract command name. So this, I'm not really proud of that, it's a bit overcomplicated. So in yellow here, we are just producing values, which are offsets of the commands in the array, and then retrieving the integers value, so the offset. And then we are using the offset file in order to print the string. So if it's not good, let me know. Looks a bit ugly to me. So here are the commands, the 50 new commands, so here in yellow. I won't describe all of them today, and the most interesting one is userpg, because the help message is start user program, and also the name is really close to userprg, which is one of the SPI section names. So what we can do next is try to reverse this function and try to execute some code, my code. Okay, no. Not yet. That's the whole content of the function, string instruction. Again, it's calling 81.22.58, but this time with 33 as the first parameter and then 0. So, of course, what we can do is decide to reverse this function at 81.22.58. I decided not to do that, way too complicated for me. So, instead, I decided to identify the operating system. Again, I guess you know what I will do. I will use strings again. If you look at format strings, a specific pattern will emerge. And this pattern was really important. It's like three characters, underscore, three characters, the error keyword, format string, and then a function name. And in this specific format string, the WPTSK looks really promising. If you search online in a search engine, you will find the following page. And you will say that this function is part of the tkernel documentation. And it says that WPTSK is used to wake up a task. That's really cool. However, what is tkernel? I believe no one knows. So again, we need to look for that information online. Tkernel is part of the Tron family. It means a real-time operating system nucleus. It is a Japanese real-time operating system launched in 84, so 30 years ago, by Dr. Ken Sakamura from Tokyo University. The specifications are maintained by the Tron Forum. Sorry, I forgot to mention that before, but here you have links of... Tron or Tron?
Yeah. I know it, I'm from Japan.
Yeah, I guess you are the only one to know this operating system. in the room. In the room, not in Japan. And the Tron Forum is actually maintaining the specification and publishing them online. And it seems that the most used Tron implementation is called Mitron from Micro-Industrial Tron. The other cool information is that it seems that all of this implementation, tkernel, toppers, airtems, and so on, they support more than 150 architectures, CPU architectures. So again, big news to me. So I'm really surprised to discover that the card is using an OS that seems unknown to the security community. So I decided to search for information online. So big news, it seems that it's used a lot in Japan in digital camera. So it's likely if you have a camera from Kaijo, Canon and Sony, you have one. And Tron is used in their digital image processor. It's also likely used in the Joy-Con in order to handle Bluetooth communication. So Joy-Con from the Nintendo Switch. And the biggest news to me, that's also in space. So I have Tron at home and also in the Japanese probe named Asteroid Explorer Hayabusa. That's amazing to me. So going back to the cards, Black Hat presentation contained more information, so it's reduced. So FlashAir W03 uses UDOS4, which means Unified Development Environment Operating System, that implements the Mitron 4 specification. It's from Toshiba. So we managed to get the operating system to understand the operating system correctly. So we can check one more item. So memory dump architecture operating system. So we are really close to code execution, but we need to solve the 81-22-58 mystery. Thanks to auto-naming, we know the address of the telnet daemon. Indeed, this is a function that will bind to port 23 on TCP. But at that point, we don't know, or I don't know, how it's called. So we can search for this address in memory. To do that, we can use radar and use the /x function in order to look for the address of telinet in memory. And the good news is we have only one result at this address. Again, if you look closely at the data on this address, we'll be able to identify a potential task array. And it makes sense because according to Mitron specification, the tasks are included at compile time. And also, there is a fixed number of tasks. So we can have a look at this array. So here again, that's a R2 macro that will be able to allow us to iterate in this array. What we can see here, in this array, we have 34 tasks. Here on the right, you have some of them. Task 34 that the telnet function, telnet initialization function. Task 21, that's the DHCP server, then 24 DNS, and so on. The task 33, it's likely the user PG function. So why? Because when you revert that, you can see that this user PG function will display a link that is related to a user program. So if you look at the Mitron specification, you can identify that 81-22-58 is likely a Mitron service call. It's like a system call called STATSK that moves the task to the ready state. So it means that when it's used in our binary, for example, with parameter 34, the telnet daemon will start. And when it's used in a binary with parameter 33, the user PG function will be called. So it's likely that task 33, that's our execution vector. So let's try to reverse it. Indeed, it's quite short. It's less than 10 blocks, and it does three things. First, around here, it will check that the user PRG section in memory in the SPI flash is not empty. Then in blue, it will first jump to the user PRG section, and then call a function stored at register zero. And this is our execution vector. And because we are able to build a fake update, we can write our code to the user PRG section and execute it. So we can go back to the checklist and remove the last item. So we managed to discover that the FlashAir runs UDOS4, Japanese operating system, on Toshiba MEP, and we found a way to execute code. So before the demo, I must say that Toshiba is aware of this result since June, thanks to nice people at GPCert that helped me to reach Toshiba in Japan. So if we put everything together, in order to execute code on the card, we need to build a fake update. We need to write it to the card. We need to call update. And then we need to call user PG. So I'll try to do that. And in my card, live demo, we'll see how it goes. Okay, let me show you the payload. Not that interesting. It's really small. Three instructions. we are moving the printf value to R0, it will be called. R1 will contain the address of our string, and our string, spoiler alert, that's a calc. Okay, so what we can do next, we can use the update command for flashRay. It will use a bin file and build the update, and then display the value. So we will build the header, compute the checksum, and put the data after that. Next. Okay, I'm not connected to the card. Okay, just need to write to this file. Oops. Flash R, okay. Then I need to copy the update. Calc update to the file system. Okay, then I can use telnet to connect the card. Okay, next, what I can do, I can version, just to show that's .01. Then I can update the card with calc update. The update will be written to the card. Sorry, F here means that the update function is checking for the header, verifying the checksum, removing everything. And then user PG, yes. So we got the code execution on the card. We have the calc here. Thank you. Okay, so, oops, I'm lost. So this calc, I agree it's a bit silly, it's not that much. However, this is a result of many, many, many hours of work. I believe some more things can be done, for example, coursing the tools. We can do more. First, something I would like to do, write a dedicated FlashAir IO plugin, and that will be really cool to be able to dump memory directly from radar. Also, this assembly is a bit slow because it's called Python from C, so I would like to work on a binutils based map disassembly in Rust. So I did some binutils binding in Rust, so hopefully I will be able one day to do a new R2 plugin for map. And the next part, I would like to do some binary diffing with Diafora in order to identify functions in firmware .0 and .01 and .02. And the spoiler part is here. Indeed, yesterday, during the talks, I implemented this Flash IO plugin. It's not released yet, that's the only code that is not released. And this Flash IO plugin will do what? It will allow Radar to open the FlashAir fake file. And then R2 will connect to the card of Alternet, dump memory, and disassemble it. I think that's really convenient. We'll conclude with three words. First one is unexpected. So when I started this project, I believed that the card will run Linux on ARM. It was a bit different. It was a Toshiba UDOS on Toshiba MEP. Second keyword is original. I think that the first time that native code execution on the FlashAir is described. And also, it's likely a typical example of a complex analysis of an embedded system when you don't know the operating system and the CPU. And finally, reproducible. It's really important to me. I only used open source tools. They are all online, except for the FlashAir IO plugin. So you can buy one card, do everything yourself, proposing everything yourself. If you need more details, let me know, and I will be happy to help. So here, to conclude, the list of the tools that are released or used, and you can get them online. So thank you. If you have questions, I will be happy to reply.
Questions? Thank you for excellent presentation. I have a question. Did you manage to check the Wi-Fi code? There are any weaknesses or anything?
Not yet. Not yet, but there are, because they are supposed to release a firmware update that will fix crack.
Yeah, because I guess there could be some interesting remote vector.
Yeah, me too. It's something I need to look at.
Okay, thank you.
Another question?
Yeah, in front.
Would you mind to talk with me outside after the presentation?
Of course.
That is my first question. The second is, I understand that you talk the same thing in the Black Hat.
Yeah.
Is it with the same level as this one?
Oh, there is slightly more slides. I think I 10 to 15 more minutes, and there is less R2 features. But my goal today was just to come here and thank the R2 people, because they helped me a lot for this research. Mm-hmm. And to me, it was really important to come here and present that and show the results and show R2 comments and how it can be used.
Okay,
it's slightly longer. There is more details.
I'm working with the ICS security in the government in Japan.
Okay.
So I'd like to know about the background, why you pick our products of our country, and we will have Olympic like less than 2 years.
Yeah, I know. I'm planning to go.
This product is everywhere in our country. I don't think we can recall it to the market before the Olympic. So I want to know the background so I can explain to others too if I'm asked.
Okay.
What is the background? Why you choose this?
You want me to tell? Okay, that's really... I was looking to... When my kid was born 3 years ago, I was looking for a silly side project to do a really cheap photo frame. So I bought a cheap photo frame with no Wi-Fi. And these cards are really cool. So some part I skipped. These Toshiba products are really amazing because you can write your own Lua script and do a lot of cool stuff. And I spent one afternoon implementing the Lua part, downloading files, pictures from my web server. And the idea was that the photo frame will access the pictures, and it did not work. And that's why I start reversing the card.
Last question, please. It revealed the default password. Do you mention that to our JP cert about that too? 1, 2, 3.
Oh, it's in the documentation, so I didn't.
Okay, another
thing. Take time to really to tell them because it's in the documentation, official one.
One very last questions.
That's okay.
It has our own design telnet protocol that you probably figured too, but the one character send one reply and stuff like that. Did you mention about that to our JP cert?
No, but it's not proprietary. It's like just what's the name? Telnet control character you need to pass, but that's in a telnet RFC. So,
okay,
there is no. To me, there is no disclosure. That's a public. That's a typical usage of a public protocol.
Yes, but okay. Thank you very much.
We can discuss.
We can discuss later.
More questions? Thanks.